I'm Walter Podrazik, television curator here at the Museum of Broadcast Communication. I'm joined here today by Steve Jones, distinguished professor of communication at the University of Illinois at Chicago, and by Mark Lewisohn, Beatles historian and well-respected author of a definitive Beatles biography, The Beatles All These Years, Volume 1. Mm-hmm. And we're here to talk about the Beatles, television, radio, and research. Right. Mark, this is actually, you've been to the Museum of Broadcast Communication before, yes. At our previous location, and what I remember about that visit is that it was in like 1990, I believe.
90, yes.
And we watched some Mike Douglas footage with John and Yoko when they were co-hosts during the early 70s. Now, this was before most of the footage was available, just about any video form that you wished. And one of the striking things about that was just a short time before that, relatively, there was a movie about Chuck Berry. Chuck Berry, Harry Hail, Hail Rock and Roll. And in there, they had the sequence in which John Lennon introduces Chuck Berry, who's about to perform.
Yeah.
And seeing the Mike Douglas footage, which is where it came from, you realize that there was more going on. Actually, Mike Douglas comes up, he starts reading that description, and then realizes, no, John should be reading this.
Yeah.
There are two messages that were conveyed by that. One was that wasn't something that John came up with spontaneously, it sounded just wonderful. And two, the way that you learned that was to see the original context. So tell us a little bit about how, in telling a definitive Beatles story, you use resources, television and radio and printed matter, to fill in details like that.
Yeah, so I remember that day well, coming into the museum in 1990. We also watched Shindig, which in the days of, particularly now the internet, but with VHS and DVD, we got to see all these things, but there was a period of time when you would only have heard of something and you hadn't actually seen it ever. So that was a great thrill to come here that day, and I remember it very well. In to answer your general question, it's hard to be specific other than to say that when you're doing an in-depth biography or an in-depth account of any kind, you really do need to immerse yourself in the original materials, as original as you can get them to the moment that they occurred. So if you're, say, searching for a piece of news information and you find a newspaper that's indexed or archived on the internet and you can go straight to the article you're looking at, you can find the very thing you were looking to see, except that in so doing you don't get to see what's on the page before it and the page after it and above it and below it. Well, similarly, when you're researching broadcasting materials, it really does help to hear the entire program that contain the moment that you're seeking, because then you get to hear the context and you get to hear the tone of voice, the attitude, what else was going on in the world that day. You just might get an extra insight. So context is always everything, and the book I'm writing all these years is certainly an attempt to tell the Beatles story contextually, because they didn't exist in a vacuum. So they're always part of a scene with other things going on around them. They've got friends, they've got rivals, other artists are having different experiences. So you look at all of that as well, and then that helps show the Beatles story in the truest context. You actually get to see what was going on at the moment that they were doing all these things, and that's the ultimate. If it happens to have resonated for a long time after that, so be it. But really, the creative moment is when this sparks into life, and that's the one you need to understand the most.
Steve Jones, you've done quite a bit of work with the internet as a means of preserving history and passing on information. So you have an archive, such as here at the museum, but you also have the World Wide Web. How do these work to fill some of those gaps that Mark's been talking about?
Well, to echo and amplify what Mark was saying, one of the really critical things here is context. And you can't get that context by just searching out that little snippet that you'd like. Part of the context here has to do with reception. So what was the audience saying when they were watching that broadcast? And that includes commercials, too, right? Because that tells you something about what this entire experience of viewing at that time actually was. And you get none of them. You could, I mean, YouTube is wonderful. Google's great. They're very handy ways of finding information kind of in the moment. And then you get that piece and you move on. But if you really want to understand what was happening sort of contextually, culturally, at that given time, you can really only get this archivally. And the other difficult thing, of course, if you're doing research on this, is that in many markets, the commercials were completely different from others. So if we were seeing it in Chicago, we might see commercials for, you know, Z Frank or any other local, for Wholesome, whatever other local companies there might be. But if you were in Cleveland watching the Mike Douglas show, you might be seeing a completely different set of commercials. And that's not only relevant in terms of reception, but also in terms of a researcher understanding the audience. Because commercials will tell you who the programmer believed the demographic was for that broadcast. So you can also start to see a little bit about, you know, how did this particular telecast fit into this larger local context, as well as kind of a much larger cultural context as well.
One of the collections that we have here in the museum is recording every night's local news for more than two decades. Yeah. And so when you're researching a story, whether it be a pop culture story or a hard news story, you have exactly the context that that you gentlemen are talking about. What makes the Beatles transcend all the limits that would usually be attached to something that goes back half a century? In other words, why would people care to research what the Beatles did 50 years ago, 40 years ago? What is it about the Beatles that makes it worth, how many thousand pages is the first volume of your
Well, the bigger edition is 1,700 plus pages.
The cutdown's only 1,000.
Yeah, a pamphlet. I'm actually tempted to answer it by saying that if we actually knew the reasons why, we would form another group and be managers,
which is an allusion to them.
Well, that was their pat line, because they were continually being asked, what is it that makes you so different from everybody else? Why do you think you've assumed such an enormous popularity? And that was their brilliant comeback: if we knew, we'd form another group and be managers. And whatever made them so special then, that was actually very hard to define, because it touches in so many areas, is still the case today. The answer would be the same. But distilled down to its most simplistic form, I would have to say that they were great originals. They were original in everything they did, even when they were taking an art form that already existed, like American R&B, and doing it themselves. They actually made it as if it was their own. They were true originals in everything that they did, and particularly the way that they thought. And I think that's what came across: their naturalness, their sense of humor, their sheer personalities.
Were they particularly well suited to using television? Because they made an incredibly strong impression in the US on the Ed Sullivan Show. A lot of people had appeared on the Ed Sullivan Show. A lot of entertainers had appeared there. And yet they are the ones that stuck.
Yeah.
What is it about their relationship with television that worked so well?
They were the right generation for it. They had grown up, not exactly grown up with television, because in England we had generally the everyday common people had television a little later than you had it in the States. I think I actually did identify as best I could when each of the Beatles had a television in their house, and typically it was between 1956 and 60-61. But they absorbed television, they absorbed all popular culture, and in Britain in those days we had only two channels, and they kept quite respectful hours. They would be shut down in the afternoon, no breakfast television. It would come on maybe 4 o'clock in the afternoon and finish at about 11 at night. And being that there were only two channels, what you would call a water cooler moment would be happening on a daily basis, because people always did see the same things. So you had all those common areas of knowledge with, I mean, they would do in the cavern with their devoted Liverpool audience of 300-400 fans, kids, they would do TV skits with them, which the audience recognized because they too had seen those shows. So they were the television generation, and radio as well. I mean, radio was huge part of the Beatles' success.
Well, actually, I was going to transition right next to radio, because some of your earliest research work back in 1980 is you went and chronicled all of their radio appearances on the BBC, which sounds like, well, great, they were on radio. No, they were on radio in a very particular way. How was radio suited for establishing a bond between them and fans who weren't at the cavern?
Well, that particular research was into the Beatles' BBC radio sessions.
Mm-hmm.
They had sessions to make records. They also had sessions for broadcasting, mm-hmm. which was quite a common thing in radio going back to, what, the 1940s, I guess?
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, earlier,
all actually. The great American artists had their radio shows. And I've seen the discographical books that detail everything Sinatra did on radio. Well, similarly, the Beatles had a radio career. And it owed primarily to a thing called needle time. Needle time was a restriction placed on the broadcasters in Britain by the musicians' union, because they were so scared that if radio stations could play records, they wouldn't book the musicians to do actual live work. So they restricted to an extraordinary degree how many records could be played on the BBC per week. And it was something like 22 hours across all its different networks, which is nothing. I mean, that's not even one day's radio. So the BBC had to be very careful with how many records it played. They had to log every single song and calculate minutes and seconds. And that left the airways free for other kinds of music. Indeed, as the Musicians' Union wanted, it encouraged the booking of live musicians. So the Beatles would be booked to go and do sessions, and the best way for them to be heard on the radio was to actually go into the BBC studio and do half a dozen numbers, and they will be played on the radio one Tuesday afternoon, say. And, you know, a couple of million kids would hear that. And, you know, though they wouldn't necessarily hear the records being played, they would hear the sessions.
What about around the music? That is, any kind of banter with DJs or hosts of these programs?
Well, this is the other thing, and it comes back to your question about, for example, the Ed Sullivan Show. Now, when Elvis was on the Ed Sullivan Show, you got all the movements, right? You didn't just get him singing, you got all the movements. And pretty much anyone who had been a star before the Beatles had some kind of something to look at. The Beatles just stood still. They didn't actually have a physical act. They just stood still, and what they projected was their personalities and their music, and it went mainstream into 73 million Americans. And yet, even then, you didn't see them speak on that show or tell jokes on that show or just be themselves. That was a joy to be found in other broadcasts because they were so engaging as personalities. And this was new. Elvis never came to Britain. As you can tell from the way I'm speaking, I am English. But what we knew of Elvis was that when he was interviewed, he would call the journalist sir and be very respectful in his answers. He was meant to be the rebel, and yet it would be yes sir or no sir. And the Beatles were just incredibly cheeky and irreverent with whoever was interviewing them. They always pricked the pomposity of anyone who was trying to, you know, be too straight with them. And that came across in wonderfully well on radio and particularly on television.
Steve Jones, do you have memories of your first television and radio exposures to the Beatles' personalities, and or their music, or are they totally intertwined?
They're largely intertwined, but my first memories of their personalities come from their movies.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, thinking particularly with Hard Day's Night, you know, this is... that it was a documentary, right? I was young enough to think, sort of going into this, you know, this is the real thing. It's not fiction. It's not even fictionalized. It is sort of the real thing. And this is how they are, and this is what they go through, and so on. So it was really that sense of, you know, getting a very mediated image in long form you know, not a single interview or a radio program or even, you know, Ed Sullivan or something. But I mean, it was a long form, you know, sort of a day in the life of the Beatles.
And did you see it in the cinema or on television first?
Oh, no, it was in the theater. Yeah.
It's striking, though, that A Hard Day's Night, as you described, looking like a documentary, a black and white documentary to boot, that it seemed particularly well framed for television presentation. So that if you were watching at home, it was even more intimate than if you're looking at the big screen.
You know, one of the things that's, I think, really interesting about that, and I don't pretend to be a film critic, but if you look at the sensibility, I think, of the Beatles and of Richard Leister, and the writers as well, it's like you're looking at a TV show more than you are, you know, a film, in quotes. It's really intended to be in your face. It's up front. There's not a lot of switching between, you know, foreground, background. It's very, it's very kind of television dimensional, if you will, not, you know, sort of kind of the depth of film work, and the pacing of it is very much televisual. Mm.
As if you have commercials intercut with scenes, except they happen to be other scenes.
Right.
Mm. Mark, you mentioned being from Great Britain. What are your earliest memories of the Beatles? I mean, are you what would be called a first-generation fan?
First-generation fan, but young. I was 1963 is when it happened in England, a year before America, and I was five. And it wasn't television. It was the sound of a record. It was I Think She Loves You. Sometimes I think it was Please Please Me. It's becoming someone else's story almost now. But it was the excitement of hearing She Loves You. No record had ever been made that sounded anything like She Loves You. And it was so dramatic, so immediate, so incredibly infectious and engaging that it was like, even though I was five and I didn't know anything about what had preceded the Beatles, I knew it was new. And it just hooked me completely in the way that it hooked so many other people. And my mother, who was then 39, who in her younger years had been a fan of Hollywood film idols and had kept scrapbooks like a lot of kids did in, you know, 1930s, she cut out a photograph of the Beatles from a magazine and stuck it on our kitchen door. But she didn't do that at all at this point in her life, but the Beatles appealed. There was something about them that she liked. She liked the music, but she also liked their looks and the way they dressed and their hair and everything. So I remember seeing the photograph on the door. I don't actually recall the first time I saw them on television. It was probably on Top of the Pops or something like that, but I can't recall the precise moment. But I used to be bought the records for Christmas and birthdays, and then when I began to have any kind of collection of money of my own that I would be buying. The first album I got ever by anybody was Sgt. Pepper, and I was nine, and it was the most dazzling kaleidoscope of sounds and images that, well, I'd never considered it was ever even possible, and I was entranced for years. I still am.
I'm struck by your mentioning of Sgt. Pepper, because I remember purchasing Sgt. Pepper, bringing it home and listening to it with my mother.
Yes.
And that's what I find fascinating is the Beatles come across either via radio or television as accessible to multiple generations.
Yes.
Did coming through the warmth of television help foster that?
Yes.
My earliest memory of them was the first Ed Sullivan appearance, but it wasn't remembering them or their performance. It was remembering the fight that ensued between my grandfather, who loved them, who thought that they were phenomenal, and my father, who thought they were just garbage.
And where did you come in on that?
I was on the side of my grandfather. But that was because I was just on the side of my grandfather. I don't think I had much of an opinion of the Beatles.
Like, grandfather likes it, son doesn't.
It was really interesting that way. That something of that sort would even appeal, you know, to the generation beyond. At that moment was just absolutely remarkable.
But we're talking, I mean, everything became quite narrow after the Beatles in that, you know, the music would be aimed at an age group and you didn't want to like it if other generations liked it because it was, you wanted it to be yours alone. But the Beatles were so new and so original and so enjoyable that naturally they were enjoyed by people of different ages, because you wouldn't get a 35, 40-year-old or even 75-year-old saying, I'd like to like this, but I can't because it's guitar music and I don't want to like guitar music. We didn't. There had been no guitar music really before the Beatles. Guitar bands, as we know them, began with the Beatles. I mean, they would say, well, actually it began with the Crickets, but the Crickets never had the mainstream mass popularity. No one even, Buddy Holly people remember, but not the Crickets. The Beatles were the first guitar band, and that was a difficult thing for people to swallow. I expect your father didn't like the idea of three electric guitars being plugged in.
It was the hair too.
And the hair as well.
The hair was dreadful.
But in England, certainly, you would get grandparents, people of all ages, and that was one of the extraordinary things about their breakthrough. And when the media went around outside the theatres, when kids were queuing for tickets and other people were stopping, you get people of all ages saying, oh, I like their music, you know? If you look at any of the scenes of Beatlemania, particularly in Britain, there's grannies in the crowd, you know, and Stones fans might say, well, you know, I prefer the Stones because, you know, they didn't attract the grannies, but the Beatles couldn't help but attract the grannies because what they did was so enjoyable to so many people. And yet at the same time, it was so cutting edge.
But it's an important, you know, it's an important point in terms of what, if I could use the term genrefication, right, of
you
television.
Can't, you can't use that
I can't
term.
Use that term.
No, can you use another one?
I could try, but it might take me rather a while. The demographicization.
Yeah, that's good.
Is that better? Because
no.
It's much harder to say. because really, I mean, one of the things that was operating at the time the Beatles were hitting the U.S. in particular was mass culture had really kind of hit its peak.
Yeah.
And so it's hard to imagine. You know, and you'd mentioned this in terms of, you know, television in the UK and the water cooler moments and you know, and sort of that common culture that one had thanks to the media. I mean, that was operative here as well. So, you know, Ed Sullivan, I mean, that was the show. Mm. You know, this is what you watched. We had a half dozen, maybe eight channels to watch, but it was pretty clear what the ones were to watch at a particular moment. So if you appeared on those shows, and that's why it was critical for them to get on that show. But these were, you know, variety shows. And so you would get all ages.
Yes.
And you did not have a presentation of a performer toward a particular demographic at that point in time.
Yeah.
But it wasn't long after that it became very much restricted by age group.
Yes.
I mean, at the time in the U.S., the broadcast networks had recently increased the length of their nightly newscasts from 15 minutes to 30 minutes, had made a greater commitment to doing more news documentaries, getting their cameras out of the studio and out into the field. And in that sense, the Beatles may have arrived at the perfect pop culture time simply to a medium that was waiting to cover them or whatever came next.
Yes.
They had sort of had a tryout in the coverage of the Kennedy assassination just a few months before, bringing all of those resources together. And with the Beatles, it was a lighter story, but it was still a news story that they could spend more than a few minutes on. In the portrayal of the Beatles in the news medium, and I ask you both from a U.S. and a U.K. perspective, how were the Beatles treated as a news story, first in 63, for instance, going into 64?
Well, the story that broke first was the reception they were getting, the excitement that they were stirring in people. So you would get, you know, scenes outside theatres in which they were appearing that the police were having to control. And in particular, you would have scenes outside theatres when tickets went on sale. The show might not be for another 2 months, but the queue, the line of people outside the theatre camping out overnight and adults coming round with flasks of tea and coffee to keep them going and all of that kind of thing, that was a news story. Look what's happening on our streets at this point. And it was always a happy news story. It was always portrayed well. There was no condescension in the reporting in the UK. It was just like, you know, this is what our kids are into at the moment.
And God bless them.
Yeah, but it's okay. It's okay. Yeah, adults are on hand as well to make sure that everything's all right.
What about the U.S.? Would you describe U.S. coverage as not being condescending?
It was condescending from the standpoint that much of what we have that comes from outside of our borders is seen with condescension. So it wasn't entirely without it, but it was lighthearted. It was tongue-in-cheek. The early coverage was much the same as Mark had just described. The lines, the yelling, the screaming, the scenes outside the hotels, you know, those sorts of things with the motorcade, etc. But it seemed, if you look at some of these clips now, you can tell that at the very least, it's hard for some of the reporters to kind of hold back some tongue-in-cheek remark. That they wanted to sort of get a little kind of snide comment in, and often they would. There'd be something about, maybe along lines of, the British are coming, but, we'll fight them back eventually or something along those lines.
I mean, even in the very early coverage before the Beatles landed, or CBS News and NBC News, you can see that there's a desire to, shall we say, pummel them with puns,
yeah.
and to kind of roll your eyes rhetorically,
yes.
About what was being embraced by this generation. So from a historian's perspective and from a pop culture analyst's perspective, what can we learn looking back at how that was perceived? I mean, are we any better now?
No.
Oh, okay, well, that was easy.
So, I mean, but again, this goes back to the context thing. I mean, because when you see the footage of this, right, you can read the transcripts, and we have all sorts of wonderful sources for transcripts now, but until you see, a reporter's expression as they're interviewing somebody, you don't really understand non-verbally what's going on there. And you see much of the same thing now. I mean, what we now do... We have far less coverage of these phenomena to start with. I mean, I don't see, none of the big three networks are covering Jay-Z and Beyonce, and their tour and what. So, I mean, it's not really, they're covering the potential of a divorce, but that now has its own genre, right? I mean, that's on your, entertainment shows.
Yeah, that's the entertainment gossip channel.
Right, and that's not going to be on the news, right? Unless there is a divorce, and then, if it's for big money or there's incarceration involved or something, some dreadful thing. But, what this shows is, that it's another piece of how we try to come to grips with popular cultural phenomena that don't make sense to us, meaning adults, but have enormous impact seemingly on our kids that scare us into believing that there will be some form of irreparable harm or change, at least, to our kids. And so we repeat these sort of panics, or at least semi-panics, with virtually every medium or phenomenon. I mean, so you could see this with the advent of movies, comic books, television, and then rock and roll. And so, the Beatles kind of fit more into that overall. Rock and roll, sort of the notion that we had that rock and roll was going to do something, whatever that might be, bad to our children, and it was somehow bad for them. In the same way, they going to the movies was bad because then they wouldn't be outside in the fresh air. You get a sense of how these narratives are kind of reconfigured and replayed with every new phenomenon. We've had it, and we continue to have it to a great extent with rap and hip hop, but in the present day.
A striking thing, Mark, you mentioned that the scenes would be of like kids lining up to get tickets months in advance. And if you read some of the American coverage of their first tour, inevitably it is how much this act is making for 30 minutes worth of work. Mm. Some of that was presented snidely, or can you believe they're being paid $1,000 a minute for this? But could that also have been why they got coverage in the first place? In other words, if they are making big money, then by definition, they must be worth looking at, both in the British and in the American markets.
Yeah, well, the, a lot of the coverage of the Beatles in the UK and the US in 64 particularly, was about how much money they were making. As soon as the Beatles returned from America on their very first visit, they landed in London. Are you a millionaire now? It was all about the money, because that was status. If you've made a million, then you know that is something that very, very few people can ever attain. And certainly in America, the money side was reported in Britain and the States. You know, but particularly I think on the way that in the way that you mentioned, which was, can you believe they're making all this money even per, you know, per minute? All they got to do there is stand there and sing these nonsense songs that no one can hear, and they're being paid a fortune. And you know, where's the justice in that? It was like a modern madness that was being reported. But no one ever looked at the artistry, particularly in America. But the first two, 3 years of the Beatles, no one actually stepped, I wouldn't say no one, but hardly anyone stepped back and said, you know, actually this music is really good.
Well, I mean, that wasn't going to happen with anything associated with rock and roll at the time. I mean, it wasn't just the Beatles.
It happened
in all fairness, we were equal opportunity in our condescension toward rock and roll.
Right.
It wasn't just that they were British or the Beatles. I mean, we really, nobody took it seriously, but that's part of what, you know, what I think.
It was very new, wasn't it?
Well, I mean, and that's what has to happen in a sense for it to become incorporated into the culture, is for people to start taking it more seriously.
It happened really when people like Arthur Fiedler took the Boston Pops Orchestra and did some Beatles recordings, Beatles songs. Keeley Smith did an album of Lennon and McCartney songs in quite early 64, I think. And Ella Fitzgerald recorded Can't Buy Me Love. That was a reason for, that was an opportunity for the gate to open a little bit towards the generation who believed that the music they liked was more discerning.
Mm-hmm. How did the Beatles use television, in particular, radio in addition, to move out of that? I mean, now we start looking into, perhaps you mentioned Sgt. Pepper as a first exposure of a brand new Beatles album that you bought when it came out. Were they able to use television to advance themselves into their next phase?
You want to go?
Sure, I'll start. I mean, they were brilliant, right? I mean, the notion that they would create films completely under their control and then push those out to television. I mean,
so you're saying specifically the films that accompanied Strawberry Fields,
Strawberry
and
Fields,
Lane.
Paperback Writer. You know, these what are essentially, you know, kind of the progenitors of music videos. You know, that they had the notion that, well, you know, we're not going to go out on tour and we don't really want to do these shows and put ourselves through this. Why don't we do it this way? It was a completely, now, you know, I have no idea what the thinking in the inner circle was at that time, of course. I mean, it may have been some sort of expediency, efficiency, creativity, you know, let's do something fun. We're into making films. Let's see what happens. You know, all this variety of things, but the upshot of it is that it gave them a way to completely control their presentation and their sound, which was, you know, even with television, not to mention concerts, was always dicey.
And you had mentioned for radio purposes, there was a business side or a musician's requirement side for why they made recordings for British radio.
Yes.
Was there anything similar to that going on in Britain for the television side? In other words, was some of the motivation for these films to serve a British need first and then they exported it over to the US?
Well, actually, as we've been saying, they, as Steve said, they were particularly good at exploring all the mediums going. So they made records, they appeared on radio, they made movies, they were on television, they were in print journalism, they had their own magazine. They were reaching people in through every available format. But as they, once they'd been at the top for a couple of years, it became tiresome for them to do the rounds of all the different shows, you know, in which to promote themselves. So it was far easier for them to make a film which, as Steve says, they could control artistically, they could be involved in its concept and direction, they could ensure that the sound was right because they'd be using the record and not a TV performance as such. And we can do this in our own way. It only takes a few hours, and then we send it out to people, and they show it for us, and we don't have to go. We don't have to go to America to, you know, promote our record. We can send Ed Sullivan the film of Hello Goodbye or whatever it was, and he'll show it, and maybe even pay for it as well, because in those days broadcasters paid them to show them their films, so they actually made money from doing this. But mostly they saved time and had the artistic control. And the Beatles were always about using every medium to make the most direct of communications with their audience, always.
I mean, in short, if they knew that releasing a record and following push button 1, 2, 3, and it'll probably be a million seller, yeah, let's make pushing those buttons as easy as possible.
Yeah. Yeah, in order to not be bored, in order to be able to stick around the house a bit more and do the things they really wanted to do.
Which brings us to people such as John Lennon coming out and saying, this is what I really believe, this is what I'd really like to talk about, and it's not the length of my hair. Yeah. So again, we're talking about how they may have used television to advance now a cause. Yeah. How did that begin to take shape towards the end of the 60s?
Advancing television?
They are using television to advance causes that were important to them.
Well, they, John and George went on the Frost show, the chat show, TV chat show, twice in the space of a week to talk about transcendental meditation. As soon as John got together with Yoko, the first thing he did was go on British television and become the laughing stock. But, you know, that was one of those things. That was more about how they were received than what it was they were actually projecting. But they always wanted to use television because it went straight into the viewer. You know, there was no filter between them saying their message and the person sitting a few hundred miles away receiving it. Whether it was received with a jaded eye or not was in the eye of the beholder, of the receiver. But the Beatles were, this is us, this is what we're saying. And John Lennon in particular, when he began to take up the causes of peace cause and all of that, that he used all direct mechanisms that were available to him.
Yeah, and part of, and I don't want to make it sound like they were control freaks, but I think control was incredibly important to them. I mean, they wanted to know that nobody was going to edit
them. Were they control freaks?
I think in the best sense of that of that term. I mean, they wouldn't want somebody else to edit their words. They would, you know, so the live format was something that they seemed to prefer, particularly later and even into the 70s, if they would appear.
Control freaks, no, they were artists, and they were creating something, and why have someone else come in and fiddle around with it, you know? I mean, who's got nothing to do with it. So, they wanted all direct means.
And they had some experience with people fiddling around with they'd done and realizing, and this is not a good thing.
And from the very first appearance they made on television, they hated the sound of that television had. Rock music was new. Electric guitars were really quite unknown to the majority of people in those days. If you would go in a TV studio with an electric guitar and an amplifier, the technician would have no idea how to mic it up. And then by the time it had gone through his lack of ideas, through a mixing board where the guy had no idea how to mix the sound, then it gets squashed down to this mono signal that ends up through a loudspeaker about that big in a television set in a wooden cabinet that's only about 9 inches big to begin with. The sound was going to be appalling, and it was, and they knew it. And every time they went on television, they would gripe about the sound. So control was an opportunity for them to get their sound the way they wanted it.
Starting at about 2012, a series of 50th anniversaries began to cascade into the media landscape, marking the release of their first British single, Love Me Do, and continuing on through 63 in Great Britain and through the anniversaries of 64 in the US. With half a century's perspective, using both television as a chronicler and as a communicator of image, how are the remaining Beatles, Paul McCartney and Ringo Starr, using the medium to tell the story that they want to tell?
Well, they told it. The story they most wanted to tell was the Beatles story unfiltered by anybody else. So that was the Beatles anthology.
Which is now about 10 years ago?
No more, 1995.
Yeah. Wow. Which was filtered by them.
It was, yes, that's right. It was filtered by them, but it was, they don't care about that. It's their story, and right. We're the ones who are going to tell it and let nobody else get involved. So that was them, and that was then. Really, these days, the two surviving Beatles, they're just part of a mainstream. They're on the entertainment shows like everybody else is on the entertainment shows. They go on Larry King Live because it's an opportunity to get across to a lot of people in one go. So do lots of other people go on Larry King Live, and so on and so on. It's very hard to be original now in the way that they could be back then.
Well, Steve Jones, looking at the arc of popular culture history, have the Beatles now reached the point in which the Beatles are a corporate entity which happen to have two members still performing, but are they first and foremost Beatles Inc.?
Well, I think they were Beatles Inc. for a long time. I mean, I think that's been a phenomenon that's been going on for, you know, what, 30 years now, maybe longer. I think at some point, people are more interested in, you know, Paul and Ringo as Beatles. And so it's very difficult, I think, for them to be motivated to do new work as well. There's lots of other things that they like to do. They're incredibly smart people. They have other interests. They have families. They have other things to do. And so I think part of what, you know, I mean, Paul is clearly motivated to do music. And so he does these things, but he doesn't really do them in concert. And he has other interests. And they do feel, I think, very strongly, and you can see this from the way that they've been, you know, curating is probably the word that I would use, the 50th anniversary things and reissues. And you know, when they issued the material in the UK for copyright purposes, I think it was last year, yes. So that they would retain copyright. I mean, they are very savvy business people. And they, I think, will do whatever they can to ensure that legacy and that revenue continues to go where it ought to and doesn't become diluted along the way or in the hands of others, as has happened in some cases, both in terms of their work, but drastically so in the case of other artists.
Well, sort of to go full circle, the question of why do they resonate still? I'll ask both of you, start Steve, looking at the American market. Do they? I mean, are they a nostalgia act that may reach new listeners, but the audience that they were going to reach was reached, has been reached, and just continue to revisit? Or are they still capable of reaching new generations?
No, I mean, it's pretty clear they're still reaching new generations. I mean, you look at something like the Rock Band game. You look at the audiences who go to Ringo's and to Paul's shows, and you look at their sales figures. There is no way that they're only appealing to the audience that they had in the 60s. I mean, that's absolutely clear. And so how long will that continue, and, you know, and in what form or shape? That's almost impossible to say. But the longevity that they've shown is completely astonishing. I can't really think of other performers, other artists who've managed to have that appeal over that length of time, over those generations, and across these various media. I think the reissue of their movies as well shows, you know, that this isn't a phenomenon that's rooted in its particular time or to a particular generation or demographic, that it's continuing on.
Mark Lewisohn, you've been researching their lives from before the beginning for your biography. Is there something you find in their very earliest forays into entertainment, into relationships with each other, that helps to explain that longevity that we've now looked at for half a century?
Yeah, because before the Beatles, they were John Lennon, Paul McCartney, George Harrison, and Richie Starkey. And as for young guys, they were all sharp. They were all intent on pursuing what they wanted to do in life, which was quite hard with parental pressure in the 1950s to, you know, get a proper job. They were original and they were determined to do things their way. I mean, they were incredibly tough-minded people, the Beatles. So their pursuit of their ambition was very focused. And you look at them as individuals and you look at them in the way that they related to one another, not as celebrities, but just as people, as friends, which is what they were, good friends, was so unusual. It gave them a dynamism that was able to propel them through all that followed. They were so tight. They were so of one mind when it came to how they dealt with things that, yes, you can see it just by looking at them as children, that provided these people got together and they got the breaks that came, you know, that we all need in life for things to occur, then they had it all. Which is why in the book I number each year, and 1958 is actually the first year that John, Paul and George are together and they're becoming one mind, if you like, in the way that they went about things. So that makes 1964 is year seven. So they didn't just arrive on the Ed Sullivan Show, they had a lot of history by this point. And year 13 is when they break up, which is a long time. It's not just the visible years, it's the invisible years are a part of their story too, because it's the arc of a career, if you like. But it was the most astonishing career. To stay ahead of the pack and continually renew themselves, to continually try new things, and to do so with immense humour and in a very engaging way, and keep the people with them. You know, to do something that's cutting edge and sell millions of something that's risky, it's unheard of. And I think that's what sustains them. It's just like they were just so original. And originality will always last more than anything that's been artificially put together.
I'd like to close by asking both of you, if you're trying to introduce somebody to the Beatles, either by pointing to a song, of a sequence in a film, a moment on television, what would you point to? Steve Jones?
If I had to reduce it...
To just one shot. This is your elevator pitch.
To one shot, I'd probably show them the Hey Jude broadcast on the Frost Show.
And that was a live broadcast?
Yeah, I mean, I think parts of that may have been pre-recorded and played back, just if memory serves. But yeah, I mean, it was essentially a live performance.
It was recorded as live.
Recorded as live.
Yeah.
And it was them singing the song Hey Jude with
the audience piling in at the halfway point when it takes off.
Mark Lewisohn.
Oh, that's a very good question. You'd have to go some. You could pick a few things, but A Hard Day's Night, the film A Hard Day's Night, would be a great introduction. I think the songs are wonderful. The action is terrific. They are so natural in it. They weren't actors, but they could act, actually. I mean, if they really couldn't act, it would show. Mm-hmm. But what they could be more than anything else was themselves. They could be natural on camera. And they're just so incredibly engaging in it. So A Hard Day's Night would be a good introduction.
Well, with that, thank you so much, Steve Jones, distinguished professor. Communication at the University of Illinois at Chicago. Mark Lewisohn, the world's expert Beatles historian. I'm Wally Podrazik, television curator here at the Museum of Broadcast Communications. Thank you.